Tonight's panel is Ask Fred Anything. From the serious to the silly, we invited your questions for Fred by emails and through social media, and members delivered. I am going to turn it over to Pete to tell you more and introduce our guest for tonight. Pete.
Thanks, Yasmeen, and it is great to be able to co-host tonight's episode. As Yasmeen said, our CUPE tonight is called Ask Fred Anything. And that means tonight we are putting your questions to Fred Hahn, the president of CUPE Ontario. Originally a developmental service worker with Community Living in Toronto, Fred was elected president of CUPE Ontario in 2009. And is a well-known advocate for working people across this province of Ontario. So please join me to welcome Fred. And Fred, would you like to share a few thoughts as we get beginning tonight?
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Peter and Yasmeen, and to everyone for joining us tonight on the webinar and on Facebook Live. 2020 has been quite a year, the most challenging year that any of us have ever been through. COVID-19, the pandemic, has changed everything we do. It's impacted every aspect of the way we work and the way we live. And it's been incredibly difficult and a scary time for us all. But through it all, our members in CUPE Ontario, all 280,000 of us, have been on the front line. You've been keeping our province, our communities safe and going through this pandemic. So I want to start out by thanking all of you, each and every CUPE member in Ontario. You are all heroes and you deserve to be treated that way by your employer, by the communities you live in, and by the Ford Conservative, by the Ontario government, which is something I hope we're going to get to in the webinar tonight. But the pandemic's also impacted all the ways we work as a union. And I want to thank our locals and local leaders and all of the staff, the national staff and the staff at CUPE Ontario, and all of the folks who've been working flat out to support our members through a really difficult time. This CUPE Connects tool is one that we developed to make sure that we can stay connected with one another, even though we're not together in the same space in person. Our CUPE Ontario Executive Board created a digital engagement working group, and it's those folks who came up with this idea, who developed it, who have produced every last webisode. And we've done a number of them, and they've been viewed literally tens of thousands of times. It's been quite a successful tool. So I want to say thank you to Peter and to Yasmeen and to all of the CUPE Ontario Connects digital working group folks and to all the staff who've been helping us to stay connected in this creative way.
Thank you, Fred. Now, as I explained earlier, we wanted this last CUPE Connect of the year to be a bit different, as well as asking many of the very serious questions member asked. This is Ask Fred Anything. So we are going to be asking some lighter questions that have also been submitted throughout the hour. This should in no way be seen as detracting from any of the very substantial questions, but will hopefully allow us a moment or two of levity in what has been a very challenging year for us all. Peter, over to you.
So let's jump in. Fred, we received a lot of questions, individuals, members dealing with very specific issues in the workplace. Kelly wants to know about scheduled wage increases. Jim's had a question about dealing with pay equity, such important discussion in his region. Robin has questions about how members can access help when they agreed to step up into very important positions and take charge within the workplace. But the employer seems to keep them at the lower rate of pay. Sandra has a similar question and wants to know if she could file a grievance. We've had a lot of questions, Fred, like this. So what would you advise, Fred?
I really want to thank you for this, Peter. And I want you all to know that on every episode, no matter what the topic, whether it be health and safety or how to fight racism, we always get questions from members about very specific workplace issues. You know, we're a large union. We have more than 1,000 collective agreements across the province. And a lot of the answers to those questions are quite specific. They depend on your collective agreement language, on the way in which the rules work in your workplace. But it's actually quite exciting that members are reaching out because many frontline folks might not necessarily understand the process or understand the way CUPE works. And it can be a bit confusing. I'm the president of CUPE Ontario, but as the Ontario part of CUPE, we do the political work and the campaign work, but the locals are the ones who are responsible for the collective agreements and for the specific issues at the workplace. And so we always say to members who have these kinds of questions about pay equity or about scheduling or about their wage increase or about issues at their workplace, it's really important for you to connect with your local union. Now, sometimes people say, well, how do I do that? I don't know how to connect with my local union. Often your local will have a website. So if you're in local 123, you can just Google CUPE 123. You might find their website and a way to contact them in that way. You also will have a national staff person who's assigned by CUPE National to work with your local and with the leaders who are elected in your local to assist you. We have regional offices across the province. People can also find information like that on the CUPE National website at cupe.ca. You can literally go to offices and you can go to Ontario and you can find your area. If you're in Cornwall, we have a Cornwall office. If you're in Kingston, we have a Kingston office. And if you call that office and you tell them where you work, they'll be able to direct you to the right place. If you're not sure about all of that, you're not sure, I don't know which regional office I'm in, I don't know any of that stuff, there is an Ontario regional office. They have a phone number, you can call there, you can leave a message, or you can speak to somebody during the day. They will help to direct you to where you need to go. The phone number of the CUPE Ontario regional office, so it services all of Ontario, is 905-739-3999. Okay, 905-739-3999. You can call there. You can go online and look for your regional office. You can go online and look for your local. There are people who will help to answer your question. They're stewards in your workplace. They work with your employer. They know your workplace best, and they're the best placed to get those kind of answers.
So we also had lots of questions from members about lack of recognition. All the workers who are essential to keep our public services going during the pandemic. They came from school boards, from social services workers, but particularly long-term care. I think this question sums it up. Rhonda wrote to ask, what is CUPE doing to fight to make sure that all essential workers in long-term care homes, nursing homes, are getting the same for government pandemic wage increase that is currently only for PSWs? Why are the rest of us not considered important to nursing homes, long-term care homes by this government? Cleaners, RPNs, dietitians, helping hands, and activity departments all make things run together. Are we invisible to Doug Ford? It sure seems that way, and it is not fair. Without the rest of the staff, where would these homes really be? Can you tell folks what CUPE has been doing to try and rectify this issue, Fred?
You bet. Thank you, Peter, and thanks for that question. It's all of our members are important in different ways, And that includes folks who work in municipalities and for towns and cities, the folks who are keeping our schools clean and safe and working, the people who are working in social service agencies with some of the most vulnerable in our communities. But there has been a lot of focus, of course, in healthcare and in long-term care. And, you know, the question asked, you know, are some of our members invisible to the four conservatives? And I hate to break it to you, but yeah, they are. The four conservatives have botched this from the beginning, I would say. Look, many of our members do not make the wages they deserve for the important work they do to keep seniors safe, to keep vulnerable people safe, to keep towns and cities running, to keep kids in schools learning. Lots of our members deserve more pay, but the four conservatives introduced pandemic pay in the first wave of COVID-19. They announced it was going to be given to a number of job classifications. We pushed hard for it to be expanded, and in fact, we were successful at getting it expanded beyond the initial announcement in the first part of the pandemic that ended. Then the four conservatives announced they were going to have another pay bump, this time targeted to PSWs in long-term care. We again went back to advocate. It's important for people to know they never ask us before they make these announcements. They don't consult with us or with any representatives of workers, frankly, even with our employers, about what makes sense in relation to these kind of initiatives. They are simply trying to respond, I think, to public pressure. People started to notice, as they should, that PSWs are incredibly important in long-term care, that PSWs are vulnerable, that they are on the front lines, that many of them are becoming sick, that too many of them had two and three and four jobs because they couldn't find full-time work. They were piecing together work at different locations, and the government said you can only work at one location. Trust me, our members always only wanted to work at one location. They were working two and three and four jobs just to make ends meet. And so there's been all kinds of challenges and problems here, but I want to say that we have been advocating from the beginning. We have done a number of e-actions. We have formally written to government. We have continued to try to advocate. We have called for the initial pandemic pay to be made permanent for all those for whom it was given. We are calling on any wage enhancement to be made permanent. And of course, it should be given to some of the lowest paid workers like PSWs. But it makes no sense if we're talking about the importance of long-term care. You cannot separate the team in a long-term care facility. That includes the people who cook and the people who clean and the people who do activities and the people who are doing the frontline work. All of these people, no matter what their job classification, are important. None of them makes the wage that they should make based on the important work they do for our parents and grandparents. And we are going to do everything we can to continue to advocate for higher wages for all of those workers and for others throughout CUPE.
Absolutely. Thank you, Fred. Now, we also received a number of questions on pensions and retirements, Fred. Some, like Danielle, just wanted to know when they were eligible to retire. Others specifically wanted to know about OMERS and were angry about changes to the guaranteed indexing from June. Anastasia wrote on Facebook, why was there no resistance regarding the change pushed through in June to our pensions? She said, how could you allow this during the pandemic? Do you not care about mandated services that work through the pandemic and those who risk being exposed to COVID-19? It is a shame that thousands of people will have their pensions impacted. The same people who worked tirelessly through the shutdown, risking their own lives to help our community. Now, Marie commented on Facebook that she doubted this real question would be acknowledged. But I know, Fred, you want to take this question on. Could you please answer that question? Thank you.
Oh boy, do I ever want to take it on. And Anastasia is 100% right. It was a shitty thing to do. Sorry, I just swore on Facebook. It was a shitty thing to do for them to do this during a pandemic. And actually everything she just said are the exact kind of things that we as a union put into writing officially to the staff and to the sponsors of OMERS. We did a great deal of work and organizing, a lot of it online because this was happening during a pandemic. We tried, first of all, by the way, we said to them, delay this vote, this discussion. Don't even do it during a pandemic. We begged them, we put that in writing to them officially, and they ignored it. It's a challenging situation at OMERS because it is our largest pension plan. More than 100,000 of our members are in that particular plan. And we are the largest part of that plan. CUPE is the biggest number of members, but it is run by a joint board that is made up half of union members and half of employers. Employers are always looking to make concessions and to cut the benefits of that plan, including guaranteed indexing. If we were able to hold the union side, in other words, if all of the unions who have representatives and seats voted to stop this, which is what we tried hard to get them to do, we would have been successful. Sadly, that isn't the truth. There's a two-thirds requirement. You need to get two-thirds of people, both employers and unions, two-thirds of all those votes have to vote in favor of a change. That means that the employers who have always wanted concessions, like getting rid of indexing, needed some unions to vote with them. And sadly, some of them did. Now, I want to call your attention, Anastasia, and anyone who missed this. I know we were busy. And I appreciate that you might not have seen it, but we developed a whole separate website. It's called Defend My OMERS, defendouromers.ca. If you go to defendouromers.ca, you'll see all the work that we did. And in fact, the message that Anastasia talked about, the reason why this is so important for members, we actually facilitated not only sending that message from us, tens of thousands of members sent messages, more than 40,000 sent messages to all of the representatives of the sponsors who sit on the board. We actually helped to organize that. We worked with other unions who have members in the plan but don't sit on the board. Members like the ATU, the Amalgamated Transit Workers Union, and ONA, the nurses, have members in OMERS, Unifor, the SCIU. We worked with all of the heads of those unions to also advocate against this change. And all of that wasn't successful in delaying or stopping this vote. But let me say this, that fight is not over. What they did was make a plan text change that allows them to take away indexing. It hasn't been taken away yet. There has to be another vote in order to do that. We will organize and mobilize when that vote comes. We will continue to fight for workers' pensions. We will continue to fight with others, even if that means other unions, to make sure that we can protect workers' pensions in that plan. It is too important to not do that. So if for some reason you didn't see this stuff, please go to defendouromers.ca. You can sign up for e-blasts. You can get information about this, and I really encourage you to do it because this fight is not over. It is ongoing. We have been there from the beginning of it, and we will continue to fight for justice for members in that plan.
Thank you so much, Fred. Thank you for letting our members know that CUPE Ontario cares about what happens to you and to all of us. And we will build the resistance. We will fight. We will get through this difficult time, and we will beat OMERS on this for sure. If all of us join, we can definitely do this. Now, so we promised some lighter questions, Fred. And the one seems a good one to warm up with this pandemic and everything that's going on right now. So Aaron wanted to know, Fred, how do you make yourself take time for you? What is the best way you relax? Because we know you're on the go 24/7. So tell us, how do you relax?
Well, I have to say one of the things that I've been enjoying, to be honest, during the pandemic is I've been walking so much more. And every day my partner and I go for walks. And one of the ways that I relax is that I am lucky to have someone in my life who I've been with for 20 years. His name is Carrie Peer, and he is very good at saying to me, like, honey, I think you're done for the day, aren't you? It's 8 o'clock, like, what's going on? And we got to go for a walk, let's go. It's time for you to kind of unplug here. It's important for all of us to try to find that balance. And if you don't have a person to remind you of that, you know, there's technology, there's all kinds of ways, heck, we can remind ourselves. We got to find ways to unplug from this stuff, to find joy in whatever. I've noticed trees in a whole different way during the pandemic. They're really quite beautiful trees. So that's what I do to relax.
Fantastic. Thank you, Fred. So we're going to go through some of these rapid fire style and some of these questions. Some of them are holiday themes. So Natasha asks, Fred, what is your go-to comfort food and snack? Curious minds want to know, Fred. So tell us.
I like sugar-free dark chocolate, to be quite honest. And I know people might think sugar-free, it's really good. You should try it. It's my go-to snack.
Yum, yum. Okay. Another member asked, if you were given the chance to become a superhero, who would you be and why?
Well, off the top of my head, I'm going to say, and no laughing, I would want to be Wonder Woman, and it's not for the outfit. It's because she's got the lasso of truth. Boy, oh boy, I'd love to wrap that around Doug Ford's neck. I think that would be a great thing.
Fantastic. Thank you. So the Durham Labor Council recently asked, is Santa in a union? If so, which one? Your thoughts, Fred.
Oh gosh, I know people probably want Santa to be in a union, but here's the thing. I've kind of always thought about Santa as the boss. I mean, the elves are the ones that need a union. Now, don't get me started on the reindeer. I mean, so, you know, I'm sure the debate will rage over the holidays here, but I don't know that Santa's in a union. I think Santa might be the employer, and it's those elves we need to figure out a way to organize.
Thank you. I think I tend to agree with you on that one. Here we go. Next one. Finally, in a recent Facebook post, you admitted you were a Christmas kind of guy, which is good, but that the story about why the Hallmark Christmas movies made you angry was for another time. Well, this is the time, Fred. Why do they make you so mad? What's the reason behind it, Fred? Tell us.
Here's the thing. I mean, look, they're very lovely and sentimental, but up until this year, my gosh, they were white. And it's always like the same story too. It's like at 1 hour and 58 minutes, finally the couple kisses. And so it's the same story over and over again. It's always a woman who has to leave her career and go back to a small town and realize she's missed true love. But here's the thing that makes me most mad. I cry every damn time. It's like emotional blackmail. I like every time, I know it, I have this analysis, I'm like, oh, come on. And then I cry every time. That's what makes me the most mad about the Hallmark movies.
I hear you, Fred. They are so heartwarming and so touching. I cry too, I'm telling you. I love watching them, but I need a box of Kleenex with me every time. One last question, Fred. So recently, media reports claim aliens represented by a galactical federation have been in contact with the U.S. and other countries. Do you believe, Fred?
Well, I can certainly understand why people might think that Donald Trump's an alien, but I don't know what to say about that. Here's the thing, if aliens were really going to be in touch with anyone, I really wouldn't suggest that they be in touch with folks in the States. They got enough things to worry about right now, I would say. Yeah, let's move on to the next question now.
Thanks, Fred. Okay, it's over to you, Pete.
Hello, Fred, I got one last question for you. I'm a guy with not too much hair. I want to know what hair products you use. Maybe I can get some of my hair back.
I like to say these are wisdom highlights, and I have earned every one of them. My employer was the first one that started them, but it takes a village. I was joking earlier. Many a product. Just good old cheap shampoo and, you know, clean living. That's my secret for the heartbeat.
Okay, Fred, I'm going to try that, see if I can make some of my hair grow. But this is our next question. This is a good question to transit from, Fred. Dave asked on Facebook, if you could wave a magic wand, which politician from the past and the present would you make disappear and why?
Wow. There's a list, hey? Well, I suppose people might think it would be tempting to talk about, you know, he who shall not be named, Donald Trump, but the American people have made clear about that. He's going to be gone very soon. Screaming on the way out, but he's going to be gone. Honestly, if I had to think about it, like, this might surprise people, but I would make Margaret Thatcher disappear. Margaret Thatcher was a prime minister in England in the 80s. Maybe it's because The Crown is on Netflix now, but I've been reminded of how the decision she made, the way she governed, it had such ripple. It was horrible for the people of the United Kingdom. It was very difficult for trade unionists and trade union activists in England, but it impacted so many places in the States here. It just rippled around the world. I would try to get rid of Margaret Thatcher. I know people are going to say, well, Fred, what about Doug Ford? Wouldn't you get rid of Doug Ford? But here's the thing. I mean, if I had a magic wand, I wouldn't want to waste my magic wand on Doug Ford, because we're all going to work together to get rid of Doug Ford in the very near future, friends. That's our job. We don't need a magic wand for that. We need organizing. We need to talk to our members. We need to make sure they get out and vote. We need to make sure that in those areas where they got fooled by the Conservatives, they don't get fooled twice. Fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, shame on me. Next time, we got to make sure that those areas that voted for the Conservatives change their vote. Vote for the NDP. Put people in power who actually represent members. You know, we got like 7 members of CUPE, past members of CUPE, people who were dues-paying members of our union who got elected, who are sitting in the Ontario legislature today. We could double or triple that number and send other trade unionists and actually have people who care about our communities. So I'm not going to waste my magic wand on Doug Ford. Margaret Thatcher. If you don't know the history, you can just watch it on Netflix now on The Crown and discover just why she should disappear. That would be great.
We have lots of questions about Doug Ford, as you alluded to there, Fred, and the Conservative government from our members. And Kimberly wanted to know what stage, first explain to us a little bit about Bill 124, and what stage are we with the legal battle? And do you really think we can get it struck down as unconstitutional?
Great. Well, Bill 124, just as a quick refresher, was legislation that the 4 Conservatives passed that capped wage increases in the public sector. It said that we couldn't bargain a wage increase or wages and benefits together that was worth more than 1% of total wages of the organization for a 3-year period. They called it a moderation period. Basically, what they did was took away our rights to free collective bargaining. They predetermined the outcome of collective bargaining. And the right to have free collective bargaining is actually protected by the Canadian Charter of Rights and Freedoms. It's called the Freedom of Association. It is a charter-protected human right, just like every other human right. And so our union worked along with other unions, and we have filed a case in court, as have others. I mean, so we worked in a coalition through the Ontario Federation of Labour. There are some 50 unions who are part of a coalition through the Ontario Federation of Labour. But there, some unions decided for their individual circumstances that they would launch individual challenges. And so each individual teachers union has a challenge. The nurses union has a challenge. So it is being challenged in court. We have filed that case in court. We have 3 members who are representing our class of members, a long-term care worker, a university worker, and a social services worker, all in representing different components of our membership who are impacted by Bill 124. And so that's going through a process, and some of those processes have been delayed a bit because of COVID. They shut the courts for a while. But rest assured, it is in process. It will be before the courts. And we have a great deal of confidence that we'll be successful. That's not just because it's patently unfair and by God, we should be successful. It's because there's actually case law on our side. In fact, a similar piece of legislation that was passed but not enacted by the Manitoba legislature was challenged by the labor movement in Manitoba. And the courts decided that that legislation was unconstitutional. It is very similar to Bill 124. We are confident this is going to be found to be unconstitutional. The rights of our members to exercise their right in free collective bargaining is guaranteed by the Constitution of our country. And so we continue to fight it. We will continue to do that all the way through until we get that law banished from history. Allowing it to sit there on the books is an aberration. And so rest assured, thanks for the question. We will continue to fight Bill 124 and any attempt by any government to violate our rights to bargain freely on behalf of our members.
Well, Fred, thank you for that, and that refreshes everybody's memory how important that fight is going to be, and we need to take this head on. Jason, that's the question. How are we going to get the full government to actually fix the problem things in long-term care? Mm-hmm. How are we going to get them to realize that he needs to put real money into our school to reduce class sizes so that people, kids are safe and our workers are safe and our teachers are safe, and how we need to do extra cleaning. Everybody knows cleaning is the key to fighting this pandemic. And how are we going to get that message through to the for government? And really, how are we going to understand that the challenges being faced with developmental service workers and how municipalities are really working really hard to keep things running and keep our parks safe? That's where I come from. Keep our roads open, keep our streets safe. And the full government doesn't seem to get it, Fred. What is going on? Why are they not seeing the real picture?
It's a really good question, and it covers so much ground. But let me just say this about the four conservatives. When the pandemic started, the premier did daily briefings, and he looked very sympathetic, and he sounded earnest. And I want to believe that he was, in fact, earnest. In March and in April, there was so much uncertainty, and none of us knew what was around the corner. And he didn't behave the way people thought he would behave. Because, of course, we should remember that the year before that, he had cut like crazy. Just before the pandemic, he was going to reorganize public health services in municipalities. He was going to reorganize land ambulance. He had cut resources to libraries. He had cut resources to healthcare. He had cut resources to community services and community living. People were rallying against his cuts. We had a whole campaign called Communities Not Cuts. But once the pandemic hit, he changed his tune. And he, in earnest, seemed like an approachable guy. And they started talking about how they're going to spend money. And politicians do this, eh? They talk about, we're going to spend millions of here and 15 million here and a billion there. And it sounds like so much. And it sounds good. And it sounds like they're doing the right thing. But what we've been trying to do is get the word out that, in fact, a bunch of that is just spin. And you don't got, you know, shouldn't take my word for it, although, you know, I wish you would, but don't just take my word for it. The Financial Accountability Officer, this is an independent officer of the legislature. Their job is to look at the government said it would spend X. What did they actually spend? They have issued several reports since the pandemic. The first report they issued looked at all the promises of pandemic spending. We're going to spend this much money here and that much money here, and we're going to help this. And the first report said $9 billion, with a B, billion, $9 billion was left unspent sitting there that they had promised to spend that they hadn't spent. We just had a budget that was debated in the province of Ontario that added more money to these reserves, these special funds, to make sure that it's emergency spending. The Financial Accountability Officer has released a new report that demonstrates that that amount of unspent money just sitting there is now up over $11 billion, just sitting there unspent. It could be used to decrease class sizes in schools. It could be used to train and recruit and retain more PSWs and more RPNs in long-term care. It could be used to actually pay developmental service workers what they're worth. It could be used to fund municipalities to make sure that the huge holes created by COVID-19 in the financing of municipalities is actually that they get the help they need to keep services public in communities, but in fact, they're not doing any of that. It's been difficult to break through, but I want to say thank you to our researchers and our communications team. I was able to publish an op-ed in the Toronto Star that pointed out some of these issues. It became quite popular. They not only put it on their online version, they put it in print. It was making its way around Facebook and around Twitter. The media started to ask questions. They've now started to report on the things that the four conservatives have done under the cover of COVID-19. And that's our job. That's why CUPE, that's one of the many reasons CUPE Ontario exists. It is to make sure that when governments say they're going to do something and then they do the opposite, they said they're going to spend, they're not spending. How do we make them do that was Jason's question, I think. How do we make them do that is to make sure our members see it, to make sure their neighbors see it, to make sure their families see it, to make sure we apply pressure to every MPP. This isn't just about Doug Ford, this is about your local MPP. You should be demanding they spend the money to keep your kids safe and to keep your grandparents safe and to keep our communities safe. They've got the money, it's sitting there. They should spend it, and they should tax corporations like Loblaws and Amazon and all these others that are doing really well in the pit. Their profits are going through the roof. They're paying the lowest taxes they've paid since the 1930s. I have now gone over time, I know that. Once you get me going, you got to let me go when it comes to Doug Ford. But check out our website. There's more information there. And our job, friends, is to make sure our members know this information, that we apply pressure to the four conservatives to do the right thing by our communities.
Thanks, Fred. That was well said. President, there's a lot of members asking him what is next for CUPE Ontario in 2021? Can you take a look at, like, people wondering, where are we going from here? I know it's a difficult question, but it's a question that people want to know. Hopefully the pandemic is going to be under control when we get the vaccine. And there was a lot of things canceled in 2020. The Women's Conference, Sector Conference, and also the 220 CUPE Ontario convention was canceled. Will these events take place next year? What will they look like? And can we have secure elections when we do them? Thanks, Fred.
It's a very good question. And as Peter said, we had to cancel a number of sectoral conferences, equality conferences, and our convention, our highest decision-making body. In the history of CUPE Ontario, in more than 50 years, we have held an annual convention every year, and members have made decisions and set our policy and set our framework and set our budget, and every other year voted for their leadership team. And that was scheduled to happen in 2020, and we simply couldn't do it. Like we couldn't hold a number of these events. But our executive board has been talking about this. Our leadership have been deeply engaged. We are, in fact, holding events now virtually. The first one has happened. Our Health and Safety Injured Workers Conference, regularly scheduled in the fall of every year, did occur in the fall of 2020. It happened online in a virtual platform. We learned so much from that. I want to thank our elected leaders and the staff assigned, who worked to develop a system that was as user-friendly and efficient as it could be. We are absolutely going to use that model. We're going to hold a library conference and a municipal conference and a university workers conference and a social service workers conference. All of those conferences that were canceled last year, there will be elections at those conferences. Our school board bargaining council, the OSBCU, is also holding its convention. And CUPE Ontario will hold a convention at the end of May at our regularly scheduled time. These events will happen online. They will have some differences as a result of being online, but we will have debate on resolutions, on constitutional amendments. We will have elections at our sectoral conferences and at our convention. The same rules will apply. Locals will be able to send delegates. Delegated folks will be sent links online. That's how they will be able to participate as a delegate. And there will be online voting. It is safe and secure. The democracy of our union, we've really shifted as a result of the pandemic. Many of our locals have conducted elections online. The BC Federation of Labor held an entire Federation of Labor convention with elections online. CUPE Alberta held a convention online, and so too will CUPE Ontario. It will be safe. We will guarantee the sanctity of our democracy, but we will have ways for members to directly participate in the democracy of our union, both at the sector level and for all of us in CUPE Ontario, and any member can run. When it comes to CUPE Ontario and our convention, if you are a delegated member from a local affiliated to CUPE Ontario, you can run for any of the positions that will be up for election at our convention, including that of president. And all of that information will be on the website. It will be shared with local unions, and more information will come as we get closer to the event. But I want people to know, we have adjusted to this new reality. I look forward to the day when we can be together in rooms again. There's nothing I would love to see better that it's members face to face. But until that time, we are not going to let the democracy of our union stop. We are absolutely going to hold these events in a safe and a secure way, and the democracy, the internal democracy of our union, will continue.
Absolutely, Fred. Definitely, we are moving with the time and we're hearing our members, and we want our members to be engaged. So we will definitely hold our convention, and we will have our elections and everything that we need to do. So, tying into this, there was a question that a member asked. She asked, what to do if members are being bullied or intimidated by elected leadership? What can you do? If in your union that happens, where do you reach out to?
It's a challenge. I want to start by saying that we have an equality statement. And it makes it very clear, any behavior that creates conflict prevents us from working together to strengthen our union. And that means that we hold ourselves to a very high standard with the way we behave and interact with one another. Debate is fine. In fact, debate is essential to our democracy and our ability to move together as a union. People have to say what they think, and they have to be able to express their views and debate with one another. But that has to be done in a way that is respectful, and at the end of the day, respects each of us. Certainly, if people are experiencing bullying in the workplace, then it is the responsibility of the employer to deal with that. And it is the responsibility of your union to support you through that difficult time, should it be happening at work. And you should be talking to a steward. You should be looking for a workplace policy that your employer has in relation to harassment at work. But if this happens in our union, and we're not immune, CUPE is an organization made up of people. By definition, that means we're not perfect. When situations happen like this, when people are feeling intimidated or bullied by others, naturally, the first piece of advice we would always provide is that you should go to that person and tell them, stop it. This is how you're making me feel. If you feel like you can't do that, then you should approach other folks in your local union. If you feel as though the folks inside your local union aren't appropriate, you could and should talk to the national staff rep assigned. I don't know who that person is. Again, go to CUPE. They will help to direct you to the right person. You can go to the regional office for your area. You can contact the CUPE Ontario regional office. Our responsibility is to find ways to deal with this. There is a procedure in the National Constitution, a trial procedure which speaks to this. It allows for mediation of events it's between members. But here's the thing. This is hard and challenging and difficult. Fighting the employer is easy. Fighting Doug Ford's easy. Fighting each other, it's almost more draining and more difficult. And what we must do is find ways through that difference. Because when we fight each other, when we spend energy fighting each other, they win. And I don't know about you, but I don't want to let the employer win. I don't want to let the Tories win. That doesn't diminish. Please, no one should hear that as diminishing people's rightful feelings. If they feel as though they're being intimidated or harassed, we have a responsibility as a union to sort that shit out. It's not easy, but it can be done, because at the end of the day, even when we have disagreements, I believe we all want the same things. We all want our members to be successful. We all want our work to be recognized for how important it is. We all want better public services in our communities. We all want these things together. The way we get there can sometimes cause conflict. And when that conflict happens, we need to name it and deal with it in an upfront way. We need to be kind and generous with one another. We have to remember this has been so stressful. These last 10 months have been so stressful that sometimes people take that stress out on each other. Sometimes it's easier to take that stress out on your union members rather than the employer. You're afraid of the employer, they could fire you, but you can take it out on your coworker. That's not okay. We got to fix these things. And so anyone feeling this way should address it. Look to your local for support. If you feel as though that can't happen in the way that makes sense for you, look to the national union and the staff rep assigned for support. Reach out for help. There are lots of folks in the union who will try to help to fix this internal problem, because once we fix that internal problem, we will be stronger to fight for what we all want and what we all deserve: better public services, better government in Ontario, better work, and better pay. Those are the things we should focus on.
Absolutely. Thank you, Fred. You're 100% right, Fred. People that are elected into the executive board of their union and stuff, it doesn't matter whether you're an elected official or you're just a member, we're all the same. We are all fighting for that same thing. We want better for ourselves and our future for our children. So we just have to remember that united, we will stand, and divided, we will fall. And so well said, thank you, Fred. So for our last questions tonight, we want to really focus in on the pandemic. We got a lot of questions about the vaccine. Folks are wondering when they'll get it. Others are wondering about its safety. Many questions about how employers will deal with it. Where should members go to for answers on these questions? Because there is a lot in people's mind, like, will I be forced to take it? Especially if I'm a frontline worker, what's my right? Where do I go? If you can just shed a bit of light on that, Fred, please.
Absolutely. It's no surprise to me that there will be lots of questions about the vaccine. It's pretty much all that people are talking about on the radio and on TV these days. And I want you to know that I am part of the CUPE National Executive Board, and we talked about this issue there, the importance of communicating to locals and to leaders and to staff and to members about the vaccine. There's a recognition that a bunch of this stuff will unfold slightly differently across the country. There are different rules and laws that have developed in different provinces, and healthcare and these kind of rules are pretty provincial. And so there will be an Ontario fact sheet that is being developed that will come out to help people, to give people some information about the vaccine. It's important to understand a few basic things though. We have members for whom the requirement to get a vaccine as part of their job has been there for a long, long time, like long before we had COVID. That's been a reality for some of our members. And we have also, in the past, particularly this was around the flu vaccine, probably 15 years ago, we put on a campaign, particularly for paramedics. The employer at that time, the province, tried to make it a condition of their employment that they had to get the flu vaccine, otherwise they wouldn't be able to work. And we argued at the time that it ought to be, that it cannot be a condition of work, that it should be voluntary. And at the time we were talking about, you know, the flu shot, the regular flu shot. At the time we were talking about something that, you know, not even a third of the population was getting. We're in a very different situation now. I want to be clear about something. I get the flu shot every year. I started getting it when I was a frontline worker. It was beneficial for me. It was beneficial for my coworkers. I got a flu shot this year. I went to a public health clinic run by our members in Local 79 in the city of Toronto, who injected me with the flu vaccine. And when my time comes for this vaccine, after all of the others who are ahead of me in line, and they should be, I will go and get this vaccine. But I think it's important for us, you know, to understand some very basic things. And I want to recognize and say thank you to the Ontario Council of Hospital Unions. It's one of our bargaining councils in the province, and they've turned their minds to this. And this is very much like what we are going to, the sort of direction that is going to come out to all of you. And it's based on some principles. First of all, we support and encourage vaccination. It's an important message to begin with, that we support and encourage vaccination, but we also believe vaccination should be voluntary, and that vaccination for people who are contraindicated, they have to be exempt. You've probably already heard that some people with allergies it's not being recommended that they would take the Pfizer version of this vaccine, that vaccine can't be used for younger people. So of course, those folks who have health concerns should be exempted, and people should be talking with their doctor about that. And to be effective, a vaccine has to be available comprehensively to everybody in a workplace. You know, we're back to this example of long-term care. Sure, it's great to give it to PSWs in a voluntary way, but it's important to make sure that the dietary aides and the cleaners and the nurses and everybody in that setting and all of the residents and all the people who visit them, like, to be effective, it has to be available for everyone in a setting. And it's also important to understand that when we're talking about the vaccine, we still have a workforce in healthcare, but also in community congregate care settings, in shelters, in women's shelters, in developmental services, who are still being denied the proper personal protective equipment to actually keep them safe with an airborne virus. Our union has done a great deal of work, along with others, to try to institute better guidelines and better access to PPE and to personal protective equipment. But the fight to ensure personal protective equipment is actually available, the right personal protective equipment is available for all workers, is not over. It continues. We must apply pressure to employers. It is their responsibility to provide this stuff, not to keep it under lock and key or to ration it for shift. It's their responsibility to provide the proper PPE. To workers. And that can't be divorced from this important message about the fact that, you know, look, we are in a global pandemic. Capitalism shut down. Like, let's be honest, eh? Like, around the world, capitalism shut down. So they poured billions of dollars and all their energy into creating this vaccine. They did it faster than any other in history, but by God, of course they did. Capitalism demanded nothing less. They weren't going to have everything shut down forever. And so they have done, Health Canada has looked at this. We got to have faith in that process, and we do. So we support and encourage vaccination on a voluntary basis, as long as it's available for everyone in a site, and we're going to push for that. The people who are counterindicated should be able to be exempted. And that this discussion about vaccination can't be divorced from the ongoing fight for proper PPE in every workplace to keep every worker safe.
Fantastic. Thank you, Fred. So we've got a lot of members writing in with questions about mental health. The pandemic has no doubt made situation worse, but many folks were also struggling before the pandemic. One member wrote, I'm on a stress leave due to extreme anxiety levels and a difficult, to say the least, situation at work. Is there a way to get a list of recommended psychologists, social workers, et cetera, who specialize in helping patients with anxiety and related anxiety disorders? Other sources of support would be appreciated also. All of us who are active in our local are seeing more and more members grappling with mental health issues, either themselves or within their families, or both. What do we need to do as a union to make sure people have the mental health supports that they may need? Fred?
Thanks so much for that question. It's so important. I want to start by thanking our Health and Safety Committee and our Injured Workers Advocacy Committee. They've been talking about the importance of mental health long before the pandemic. They actually developed a handbook on mental health supports long before the pandemic. Many of our locals actually got stewards to become what can be known as mental health stewards and did some mental health first aid training. And that may be available in your local, and you should be in touch with folks in your local union to see if that's possible. If you're from a local that is just hearing about this for the first time, what do you mean I can do mental health first aid, or I could train people to become mental health stewards? I think some of that information, and if not, I'll make sure that we put it there, will be on the CUPE Ontario website, but you should also talk to your national staff rep, because some of the mental health first aid training can happen through the CUPE National Union. We also have an Ontario Mental Health Guide on our website at cupe.on.ca. It's a booklet on mental health, and you can look it up in the search function of the website. This is incredibly important. Your workplace may also have an employee assistance program, an EAP, that you can also and should also be able to access for some mental health supports as well. This has been a very stressful time, and I hope that one of the things that the pandemic will show us, because out of every bad thing comes something good.
Yeah.
And one of the things I hope this helps to really finally drive home is that mental health is as important as physical health.
Yes.
We tell people, don't go to work with a cold, don't go to work with sniffles. Make sure that you get looked at, go to the doctor if you have a pain, or you get your regular checkups. The same thing is true for mental health. That isn't the way we were raised, many of us, but it's very true. And so I'm very hopeful that the pandemic will actually be able to help us reframe the way we see the importance of mental health as just as important as physical health. The CUPE National website also has some resources on mental health. I should say, go to cupe.ca. /mental health, and there's resources there. So there's a bunch of things that we're building more because we recognize this is a big issue and a growing issue, and our union needs to be there for our members and our leaders on this issue for sure.
Thanks, Fred. Finally, I think as we've discussed, it is important to check in with folks, right? It's extremely important to check in with your family and friends. So Fred, how are you doing now as 2020 is drawing to a close? What are you looking forward to in 2021?
I will confess the first number of months of the pandemic was really quite difficult for me personally. It was difficult because I'm so lucky to have the role I have in our union. And that role means that I'm often with people together in rooms. I go to membership meetings, we hold conferences and events. I am with our members. It is the best part of my job. And I wasn't able to see people, and that was really difficult. And I also knew that our members were going through such difficult times. At the height of the pandemic, we had more than 30,000 members in Ontario laid off. At the same time, we had members working 12 and 14 hour shifts with so much uncertainty and fear, people living in trailers in their driveways because they didn't want to infect their families. It was a very challenging time. but we have come through those challenging days. It's taken us a while to adjust, to be able to figure out these virtual ways to connect with one another. I am looking forward to 2021 because there was good things in 2020. Look, we actually had a strike in 2020. Local 5257, childcare workers and Montessori teachers at Bladesdale Montessori School in Durham region. So more than half of the bargaining unit making minimum wage. The employer thought, it's a pandemic. You'll never do it. You'll never go on. Our members said, no, we're worth more than that. They went on strike. They pushed that employer. They forced them to have to pay them more money. Not everything they're worth, but by God, more than the employer was willing to offer. We did that in a global pandemic. We can push on long-term care in a global pandemic. We have more support now from average Ontarians on a on the issues of long-term care, on the need, the absolute need for a legislated hours of care in the law, that every senior deserves 4 hours of hands-on care a day, something our members have been advocating for more than a decade. And we can get profit out of long-term care. We can finally say that the care of our parents, our parents and grandparents should not be traded on the TSX. It shouldn't be corporations that are taking public money and then paying big dividends to their shareholders while they're not buying PPE for men. No more corporations, no more profit in long-term care. I believe we can do that in 2021. We can do that in 2021. The pandemic has changed so much for us, but it has also opened doors. It has opened people's minds. When people say they don't want things to go back to normal, they want things to be better than they were before, now's the time for us to do that. And so I'm looking forward to that mobilization in 2021.
Thank you, Fred. Pete?
So I really want to thank you, Fred and Yasmeen, for joining tonight and for our final CUPE Connect episode. I really enjoyed it for 2020. And to all the members watching and sending questions by email and by social media, it really makes me believe that we are engaged, that we are going to grow as a union, that we are going to make a difference in 2021. As you said, Fred, we'll be posting this CUPE Connect on our website and YouTube. You can go to youtube.com.user.cube.ontario videos to view this episode. And make sure you do, and because I believe it was a really good episode. Fred, Yasmeen, thank you.
Thanks, Peter. As Fred said earlier, there are going to be a number of online CUPE Ontario conferences and our convention in 2021. So check out our website event at cupeontario.ca for more information. Until then, and until we meet again in person, hopefully someday soon in 2021, please stay safe and have a great night, everyone. And here is hoping for a happy and safe 2021. In closing, I'm going to ask Fred, do you have any closing remarks for our members?
Oh, I'm so proud to be in the same union with you. Happy holidays. Please get some time to rest and recharge. For those who work through the holidays, thank you so much for all you're doing for our communities. Have a wonderful end of 2020. Let's get the end of this dumpster fire year and let's move on to 2021 and on to the mobilization we have. Thanks. Yes. Thanks, everyone.
Take care, everyone. Bye. Have a great evening.